PlayStation 5 has now been available for 2 years. Since its launch back in 2020, a lot has changed for the games console, as it's seen a price increase, major software updates, and increased selection of games. With all that in mind, is the PS5 still worth a purchase? Here's our re-review of PS5 2 years on. I was hoping I'd warm to PS5's bulky design in time, but I still have many issues with it. The console's massive, to such an extent that it's difficult to fit inside the majority of entertainment centres. The digital edition is slightly slimmer, but not by much, meaning you'll still require a similar amount of space to house the console. If you're not a fan of the white and black look, you'll be happy to know you can replace the white plates with a host of different designs. This means you can return to the traditional all-black look should you wish, with the other official options including galactic purple colourway and grey camouflage print. The removable plates also grant immediate access to the console's innards for dust removal and an upgrade to the SSD, which is particularly important considering you only have 667GB of storage at default. You will need to remove the PS5's plates and unscrew a few bolts. The whole process is pretty painless and didn't take me more than 30 minutes. The PS5 is dominated by plastic on all sides, which makes it feel relatively cheap. I wouldn't say it's ugly, but I'd expect more from a console retailing for £480. Fortunately, the lackluster build quality doesn't translate across to the DualSense controller, which is a beautiful piece of hardware and easily the console's highest point. The introduction of adaptive triggers and a haptic feedback vibration serve to increase immersion to untold levels. Astro's Playroom is a perfect case study for the controller. I'd argue that there are too few games since launch that have actually taken full advantage of these features, but they certainly improve experience when present. The likes of Gran Turismo 7, Horizon Forbidden West, and God of War Ragnarok have shown us how good PS5 games can look in 4K, even if simultaneous last-gen releases are possibly preventing some of them from reaching their full visual potential. Just like the Xbox Series X, the PS5 is capable of 120 frames per second when paired with displays that support HDMI 2.1. Over 2 years into the console's life, there's still a relatively small number of games that can reach such echelons of performance right now. At launch, the PS5 did not support variable refresh rate, which is where the refresh rate of your monitor or TV dynamically syncs up with the output of your console, resulting in smoother gameplay. Some PS5 games also offer a high refresh rate mode, which can push the target refresh rate of a game in question anywhere between 60Hz and 120Hz. The PS5 also supports ray tracing, allowing developers to implement far more realistic lighting, reflections, and other graphical enhancements to their games. However, the PS5 has struggled to run both 4K resolutions and ray tracing effects simultaneously, instead providing the option to pick your own custom settings to prioritise either performance or visuals. While this is not quite the next gen dream we were promised, this is about as close as you're going to get on a console right now. Arguably the SSD where we've seen the biggest generational performance boost though, with the improved speeds resulting in instant loading times. The likes of Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart have shown how developers can utilise these super speedy loading times to great effect too, enabling characters to hop between universes without being segmented by a loading screen. The PS5's user interface feels like a natural expansion of what came before it. Sony has kept the titles that defined the PS4, but has made them smaller and less intrusive, leaving room for spectacular artwork to fill the screen alongside a few menus. In its current state, only a select number of titles can be kept on the home screen at once, with your latest applications cycling in and out depending on usage. Folder support for organising your library was absent at launch, but has arrived in an update. There's one clear area where PlayStation continues to lag behind Microsoft, it's in its subscription offering, despite the PS Plus service being completely overhauled in 2022. PS Plus now comes in 3 tiers, Essential, Extra, and Premium, each of which provides access to a library of PlayStation games. If that sounds like Sony's answer to Xbox Game Pass, then you're not wrong. The PS Plus Extra and Premium tiers are no way near as much of a no-brainer right now. Granted, the game catalogue is an absolute treasure trove of gaming, but unlike Microsoft, Sony won't be putting first-party PS5 titles on the service at launch. If you want to play them right away, you'll still be paying upwards of £70 for the likes of God of War Ragnarok on top of your PS Plus subscription. The PS5 is a beast of a console and more exciting out of the box than the Xbox Series X. The controller is amazing, with ray tracing, games like Marvel Spider-Man and Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart look incredible. That said, the PS5 is still pretty low on exclusives. Even Sony's own games often ask you to choose between fidelity and frame rate, where we originally thought we'd be able to have it all. The recent price rise is also hard to ignore, especially when the Xbox Series X give you better value for money with Game Pass. We hope Sony will soon leave the PS4 behind and start focusing on games that really push the PS5 to its limits. But even now, this is a fantastic console that feels like it's only getting started. With all of that in mind, we gave the PS5 a 4.5 out of 5 rating. Let us know what you think about the PS5 by leaving a comment below. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like and subscribe buttons. Thanks for watching!